It's time for a capital conversation. I'm Patricia Rattray, the CEO of New Revenue Consulting and Patricia Rattray Real Estate. We're going to talk for 15 minutes today about social capital and managing teams. And I'm so glad to have as my guest today, Garrett Lang from PlateRate. Garrett, why don't you say hi and tell us about your company?
Great. Hi, everybody. And thanks, Patricia. So PlateRate is the only platform in the world where you can get paid to try the best tasting food at a restaurant. And the way it works is you get a 30, sometimes a 60, you know, often a 60 and even up to 110% credit in free food to try the best tasting food at a restaurant, ordering pickup, delivery, and sometimes in the next couple of months, being able to order in the restaurant.
Terrific. And Garrett is the founder and CEO of PlateRate. So social capital is very complex. So we break it down into very small pieces through these conversations. And the definition of social capital that I use with my clients, who are real estate investors, business owners, and home buyers, is the sum of your personal relationships and networks, plus the resources derived from them, plus the behaviors associated with them that impact your health, agency, and economic productivity. Tangible benefits of social capital include things like money, labor, and knowledge, and intangible benefits include things like your sense of confidence, your sense of well-being, and your ability to take risks. So the critical question today, Garrett, is how does social capital play out when it comes to managing your team at PlateRate?
Great question, Patricia. So for me, it's all about the company culture and creating a culture that maximizes social capital. And so the way we do that is through a series of, and I'm going to break it down, like you said, into smaller parts with social capital. First, talking about money, you want employees to be paid well because you know, money actually buys happiness up until a purchasing power parity of about $75,000 USD a year in the U.S. My team members are in low-cost countries, so it's not that high, but you know, I try to pay them well on their local salaries. And the reason is because employees are distracted by money issues if they're not being paid, you know, compensated reasonably well. The other thing is it increases people's self-confidence to know that they're well compensated for their age and experience level. The second thing is about knowledge. And really, I try to create an environment where teaching is rewarded. And that's you know, a culture of continuous improvement. We refer to it as in our culture. And really, the idea is we want to compliment those people who are teaching. And we have we even have a chat channel for appreciation when someone is helpful to another team member, they can jump on there and say, hey, thanks, you know, Quan, for teaching me this. And so really the people who look good in PlateRate are the ones that are helping other people. Whereas a lot of other companies, the way to look good is to make other people look less good than you. And so therefore you look like you're better. In PlateRate, that makes you look bad. And really those employees don't stick around very long, to be honest. We've had a few of them, but not many get through the interviewing process. But we do interview for the culture when we interview new team members, similar to Amazon, actually, they interview for culture as well. So doing that basically creates a culture in which learners and teachers move up and thrive. And I think that's really a sign of a healthy culture rather than you know, the opposite, people who can make themselves look good when they're not good rising. Then you end up with a lot of, you know, not very competent leaders. So the other thing is about well-being. And so first of all, compensating people well helps their well-being. And second, you know, I have a not-for-profit that's focused on personal development and professional development. And I invite all my team members to the not-for-profit where we're hosting trainings on things like personal finance, time management, how to be more happy. You know, that way employees have the option to engage in that kind of education. The other thing that's probably the most important, one of the most important aspects of PlateRate's culture is to give every employee a voice. And the reason is because it's very frustrating if you have, if you see a bad decision be made and can't speak up about it. And normally if, you know, the boss makes a decision and doesn't like to be challenged, they're going to say it and everyone else in the room has to like it. I like to describe it as the highest paid person in the room basically says, this is what I'm going to, you know, we don't have time to talk about this decision. And so this is the decision. And so you're all going to like it. And really the unwritten rule is that if you challenge that decision, you end up looking bad for challenging it, even if you're right. And what I like to say in Play Rate is we don't have time to make a bad decision. So I want to give everybody a voice, let everybody speak their mind, talk about the pros and cons of all the options. And then almost inevitably, I started tracking this for a period and we had 100% consensus for about a month on the team that we make the most decisions on. So at that point I stopped tracking because I felt pretty good about the process. The next thing is the ability to take risks, which you mentioned as part of social capital. And there are a lot of books written about this where the idea is that employees need to have a sense of safety in their team in order to be a successful team. And the most successful teams feel psychological safety with their team. I think that culture of being able to challenge people is a part of psychological safety. And then a willingness and capability to take risks is another part. And for me, that's about allowing people to take risks, but not punishing them if the risk doesn't work out. And instead, what we do is we celebrate the successes. Some of the books that I've read have companies that are celebrating those failures too. I don't do that. I think that it's better to reward the success, but I think it's important not to punish the failures, because punishing failures makes someone more risk adverse and not willing to take those risks in the future. So the next thing is confidence. And I think I like to say, don't fake it till you make it, learn it till you earn it. And that's why we have a culture of learning, you know, continuous improvement and learning. And I think that teaching employees to have the self-confidence that they need to be successful is a key part of, you know, building up their ability to make more difficult decisions in a more capable way. And so allowing them to take risks and rewarding them for success and not punishing them for failure, and creating this culture of continuous learning where anyone can question other people's ideas. And like, if you see something going wrong, you can point it out and say, look, this is why I think that's wrong, creates this, you know, virtuous cycle of learning. And the other thing is that employees that are paid well are often more self-confident. And then the last is, you know, labor, which is basically about attracting the best talent pool. And I think because we have a good culture in Play Rate, we can attract better talent. And I think that'll only be true, more true as we grow and our culture gets more attention. And basically the idea is we can attract better talent because we have this culture of continuous improvement that's healthy. And then by attracting better talent and making those people better, we have the best employees that exist. And so that's the general idea of, like, for me, I tried to create a culture that maximizes social capital. Does that make sense, Patricia?
Yeah, it sounds like you put a lot of effort or attention towards, you know, putting in actual practices, policies, behaviors, right, that are going to build social capital in the organization. And, you know, for some, that would sound like a lot of work, right? Because a lot of companies don't pay attention to all of these, what some would say are small little things that help contribute to social capital. So what do you say to that?
Yeah, I would say, you know, for me, I think it's less work than playing political games, right? Playing political games to me is draining. And so I don't have any interest in that. And that's why, like, I did a survey recently of our cultural values. And I was very pleased that everybody said that our cultural values, they either strongly agree or agree that our cultural values are what we say they are on the website at playrate.com/careers. And the other one that I added the question just for fun is there politics in Play Rate? And there was a resounding 100%, definitely not, which I was really happy with. And I would say it's actually less effort to work in a political free zone for those of us that, you know, my first loyalty is to honesty and to truth. And for those of us that are really focused on doing the right thing in general, it's much easier to work in an environment like this rather than harder. Now, coming up with that culture took years of sort of refining and crafting and getting feedback from people. The culture has evolved over the years based on feedback from people where they said, well, what about this? Well, what about this? And, you know, I've basically refined the culture now and I don't get as much feedback on it, or I haven't gotten feedback in, you know, 6 months that would improve it. So now I think we're in a pretty good place, and, you know, we're living the culture that we say that we want to.
Yeah, it was a great point you made about building social capital. It really is the opposite of playing politics.
It
can be so psychologically draining to work with people where every day you're jockeying for position or wondering if they appreciate you or wondering if you're being treated fairly. And in a culture of transparency where everyone's encouraged to contribute, it's psychologically freeing and comforting to know that people know my skills, people care about what I have to say, people appreciate me. And that's totally helping create a happier workplace, but it's also helping create more productivity, right? This isn't just feel good stuff. How is it contributing to just a better, more productive workforce?
Yeah, and in fact, we have a team building meeting every week. And in that team building meeting, my hobby is practical philosophy. And so I created like what I call a personal profile. It's like a profile of like what's important to you and like what your, you know, style is, like your personality type, according to a couple of different personality tests, but then also like the things that are most important to you in life. And so we've been sort of having people rotate between filling that out and presenting it to the group. And then we get anonymous feedback on each team member, you know, after they've presented their personal profile. 2 weeks later, they present on, you know, the anonymous feedback that they got and what they're going to do to try to address the areas for development. So that's a part of our culture of continuous improvement and helping team members get to know each other better. And that's been, you know, I asked for feedback a lot, and that was something that got a lot of positive feedback, because you really get to know your team members at a level that you don't know some of your friends as much as, you know, the level that I ask these questions in the personal profile. So it's a fun exercise.
Yeah, and that knowledge of each other is really what creates more efficiency in getting things done. And I see this when I work with real estate investment groups and when I work with small business owners. You often need very easy, instant access to the highest levels of knowledge. And if you don't know who can do what, it slows you down. It can be a drain on the entire organization. And I've been in companies where employees have been there for years, and they're just discovering that a particular employee has a talent or skill set that could have been applied in a variety of circumstances. And not only was that skill set ignored, but the person's sense of self worth, or at least that person's sense of contribution to the company, right? That was a missed opportunity for all those years where they thought they were not appreciated, they were not seen.
Yep, totally. Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it's like asking, you know, actually there's another thing that I read about in leadership books that was very interesting, is that asking for a favor from someone actually increases their trust with you. And I forget the exact example they gave in history. It was something like Lincoln and one of his rivals, and Lincoln asked the rival to borrow a book. And it was someone that like they hated each other. And he's like, can I borrow that book that you have? And, you know, in doing that, it sort of helped them begin to bridge the gap, and they later became, you know, friendly. And so the concept that asking a favor is like imposing on someone is actually, even though it's intuitive, it's not correct. Actually asking someone for a favor, like, hey, could you use the skill set to help out in this part of the team? People appreciate that. They're like, oh, you actually care about my skill set and you want me to leverage it. That actually builds trust rather than feeling like an imposition in a healthy culture. In a culture where people are trying to escape responsibility, it's a different story. And I've been in those too. You know, in a culture that's healthy, where people want to showcase their skills and get rewarded for showcasing their skills, and not punished if they make a mistake, that's a good thing.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And that can really differ from culture to culture, right? There are some cultures that don't want to impose, as you said, and ask someone for a favor when that asking really is you acknowledging that that person is good at something. So these are the things that I often have to teach, because my clients are from all cultures, right? And I often have to share very real examples like that, right? Of how people feel, you know, when their culture might not kind of, you know, foster that. And so these are really great examples. So how can people find out more about your company?
Playrate.com is our website. Playrate.com/careers is about our culture and has open opportunities. And I'm happy to chat with people. They're welcome to reach out to me directly on LinkedIn or You know, garrett@playrate.com is my email, G-A-R-R-E-T-T. I'm always happy to chat with people that have feedback on the company. We're a small company. I call myself a president, by the way. We're too small to have a CEO. I like to meet prospective customers and people that might like the company. We do a lot of other stuff other than what I said, but we don't have time to cover the breadth of what Playrate does, but we can help you rate menu items anywhere in the world and share them with your friends and family. So we're a good way of just sharing your favorite menu items with anyone in your circles.
Sounds like a lot of fun, and you're definitely welcome to come back and talk about social capital again. And great. Thank you so much for being here today.
Thanks for having me.
That wraps up our social capital conversation. Hope to see you all next time.